steps of my King. All right, everyone, welcome to this episode of Pastors Unplugged. It'll go out to laity, everyone as well, because I think this is such an important topic. I've got my special guest here and a friend of mine, new friend of mine, Gary Hornsby. If I pronounce that right, you can correct.
Hornsby,
okay. And so many similarities in ministry. And he's going to kind of walk us through this redemptive work of Christ and falling forward and coming out of the pit. And his story is, well, let me just tell you up front, When you told me about what happened, I was excited and actually proud of you, because so many people fall and they don't want to talk about it. And number one, number two is many people don't realize that all of us have issues in our lives. And if we don't deal with them at some point, they will take us down. Pastors, leaders, Christians, you know, I've opened up in my past, you know, with years ago before we even started the church, you know, alcohol, you know, if I open that door again, you know, it'll take me down. And there's always these areas. And so I think when we don't talk about it, when we don't let people know we're, you know, that we're not real and transparent, that it doesn't really help them to the degree it could. So anyway, I'll let you take over for now, and then I'll ask a few questions if you kind of want to give us a snapshot of what happened. I know you were a pastor, you know, maybe how many years ago, and then, you know, what happened with all that, and then where you're at now.
Yeah, so thanks for having me. First of all, I really appreciate this opportunity just to really to give God the glory.
Yes.
And that's the great thing about it. If I was to, you know, if we had a room of 100 people that were believers in Jesus, and I went around and I asked for all their stories, all of us came out of different pits.
Right.
All of us have different stories of what we were in, but and how stuck we were, or how deep the pit was, or all these things. You know, we have all these different pits. But we all have the same hero.
Right.
Exactly. We all have the same hand that reaches down into that pit. When we cry out to him, he's the one that gets the glory for everything that we do. And, you know, the reality is, like Psalms 41 through 3 that I'm kind of making reference to right now, is when I got saved in prison as a young man, when that scripture jumped out at me, because here I was in what I considered a pit. I'm just getting saved. He is pulling me up out of this pit, set me on a foundation, establishing a new goings, giving me a new perspective on life. And many will see my life and God will be glorified.
Right.
And our life's to glorify him. What we don't understand, though, when we think about David, who wrote that psalm, that you got to ask the question, you know, wonder what pit he was talking about. You know what I mean? Because he doesn't really say which pit. And some of those pits were no fault of his own. And others of those pits, if he went and looked in the mirror, he had the shovel.
He created
it. Right? He created the pit. And you're like, which one is he talking about here? And sometimes we can, for each of our lives, right, not only when we get saved, but we realize there's going to be times in our life that we're going to be faced with different pits and different things we're going to be put in, some tragedies that happen to us when our kids might pass away before us, or just financial calamity. There's all kinds of different pits we might find ourselves in. But the beautiful part is that when we cry out to him, but that grace, there's never a pit that's so deep that, you know, I love it when the Lord says, and ask that question in scripture, is my arm too short? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
He's saying, do you think your pit, your situation, you think you're too stuck? You think you've blown it too much? You think you've really done it now? Now there's no hope for you? Do you think my arm of grace can't come down and reach down and grab a hold of you and pull you out? Right. And so then the more mature, I've been serving the Lord for 34 years. I got saved in 1988.
And then pastored after prison.
Yes, and I planted a church, pastored a church in Ranch Cucamonga called the River's Edge Church. Never wanted to be a pastor, of course. And also started a 20-acre men's ranch. Used to do all kinds of outreaches, all kinds of stuff.
Right.
The kingdom of God, promoting the kingdom of God. So when I look back, there's been several pits. And sometimes we find ourselves in a pit that can seem so overwhelming and so deep. And so, like, you know, the enemy really wants to take you out.
Absolutely, yeah.
But what I found out and what I want to talk about today is that new song.
Yeah.
He says he'll put a new song in our mouth and many shall see it and put their trust in the Lord. And, you know, we don't always get to choose our stories. And God will, as he says, he works all things to the good. But I've understood, like you said at the beginning, I learned when I am willing to just be authentic and real about my journey.
Right.
It's going to give hope. It's lyrics to a new song. And sometimes those new songs are only birthed out of another pit.
Right. Yeah.
Right.
You know what I mean? Absolutely.
You know, say, well, you want a new song? Well, you might have to get pulled out of a new pit. in order to have the new song. Yeah. But it says, many will see and fear, and they'll put their trust in the Lord. And so what I found is in my story is that, I'm, of course, I've always had a heart for leaders and pastors. Mm-hmm. I've just been wired the way, a very kingdom-minded guy. And what I've realized is my story now has given many pastors, many leaders, hope right. that they can get their life right, no matter what the consequences yeah. might come, because that was a big part, and then establish a new life.
And that's why repentance is so important, because without that, you kind of stay in that pit. You know, if you don't repent and cry out to the Lord, you stay yeah. blaming, excuses.
When you're in the pit, right, the devil wants to give you a shovel. Right, you can dig your way out of this, or like you said,
cover yourself.
Yeah,
with
cover
the
yourself.
Dirt.
Right,
go ahead and
give
cover
me a
yourself.
Shovel.
You're buried.
You're
done.
That's what our flesh, everything wants to do, because that self-preservation yeah. is a powerful emotion, wanting to preserve self.
Absolutely.
And sometimes people would rather just hide in that,
yeah.
versus just try to trudge through it without really being able to walk mm-hmm. in the victory that yeah. is afforded them. But you know, there's it's not easy to come clean.
No,
so, you know, in my situation, for me, it was literally just kind of give you a little backdrop. So when I was a young man, there was an event that happened to me that my dad had several wives. So yeah. one of his wives was younger than him one time, and they went out drinking one night. And when she came back home, I was 12, 13 yeah. years old. She climbed to bed with me. And
yeah,
so my very first sexual experience was with my dad's stepmom.
Brokenness,
I mean, with my
right
stepmom,
there.
Right?
Yeah.
And so, and just starting puberty, all that stuff. So you got all these emotions as a young man, and like you're finding something really gratifying and all that sort of stuff. But
twisted,
mentally,
yeah.
you're just trying to process.
What just
this
happened?
I love my me and my dad were close. When I say close relationship, close. So here, I'm doing something against him that just boggled my mind, and I felt like I was the scum of the earth.
Yeah.
But yet, when she would come on to me, I would feel like Superman.
Right, right.
And so I was on like this merry-go-round from hell of I would feel so bad about what I was doing, it would literally drive me to want to
back
to her because yeah. she made me feel good. Just like people, you talk about drinking, right?
Shame, guilt.
I want to drink. Because I feel so bad, and drinking makes me feel better, which in turn makes me feel so bad. Is that right?
Yep.
It's a cycle of it, or drug use, addiction, anything. So when I got saved, I thought, you know, I actually even kind of changed that story in my mind as I grew up. You know, I started saying, oh, yeah, I started off being trained by an older woman, you know, it kind of made it into a good story, right?
Right.
But see, what I didn't understand is I had made an agreement inside my heart as a very young man that I'm a horrible
person.
What kind of person does this, right? And I didn't understand what that had planted in me, and I never addressed it
right.
until I went through all this stuff. And then when I went through, you know, after I failed in my marriage, yeah. I went through like 13, 14 months of, you know, discovery, and I really went back to that agreement, of course, handled that agreement, put the truth of what Jesus yeah. says in that, and got it correctly. But what it did when that happened to me, I realized I was susceptible to certain kind of women coming on to me a certain way that triggered that old emotion.
Those right? cracks in the armor.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. You know, and I used to always, you know, there's two things that I really wanted when I was a young man, after I got saved, is I wanted to wait to have intercourse till I was married.
Yeah.
And then I wanted to be that 75-year-old guy that could mm-hmm. say, hey, I was faithful to your mom.
Mm-hmm.
Or, I mean, those were like two, what you call strong values that yes. I wanted to do. But yet I would struggle with certain women that come on to me a certain way. I would get like foggy minded.
Right,
you know what
right.
I mean? It was like
compromise.
It felt almost like something was getting released in my body that was like, man, I don't understand why I'm so foggy minded.
You think
it right
even
now.
Was demonic? You know, maybe a demonic stronghold.
Either that, or it was pushing those buttons of the way that one woman would come on to me.
True.
You know what I mean? It was doing that.
And what you told me that really, you know, is going to be eye-opening is you kept preaching during that season and leading the church because
yeah.
I can't lose all this, you know, self-preservation. Yet you were preaching just as strong because you're so broken going to the Lord. And then, you know, that dichotomy yeah. of what's happening.
It's called desperation.
Desperation, yeah.
And there's an amazing thing about when you're desperate for God to show up,
yeah.
He is grace, right?
Yeah,
and so, yeah, so let me just kind of fast yeah, forward absolutely. Today so we don't have a lot of time to talk about this. But so, and once I failed in my marriage, then of course, all of a sudden I found myself, you know, it's like I used to tell my men all the time, you know, you've heard it said that, you know, don't ever get on the train because the train will take you farther than when you need to go. It'll keep you longer than you want to stay and cost you more than when you want to pay. I mean, I preached that.
Yeah.
I believed it.
Yeah.
I discipled guys in that. All of a sudden I realized I'm on the train.
Yes.
I'm on the train. How do I get out? And another point is being I'm in a pit, right? Mm-hmm. And see, the problem is when we're a leader and we fail in that way, that the pit is so overwhelming because of our position, because of who we are, and because of the collateral damage
that will happen
of us coming clean, it's overwhelming. So the shame, the guilt, and then what happens is when you're now all of a sudden you're even more susceptible because now you're on that, it's almost like you're back on that yeah. merry-go-round,
yeah.
right? And so, but for me, I think we talked a little bit about my story, what happened at the Rose Bowl, and I had that, I suffered from sudden cardiac death on 11-11-11, and so then,
talk about that for a minute. You have a pacemaker that sometimes
yeah, defibrillator
that sometimes goes off.
Yeah, only when my heart stops. That's when it's only supposed to go off. It's went off a couple times accidentally, but
oh my goodness! Yeah. But so, you didn't have that at the Rose Bowl.
No,
that's
no.
what caused
so,
you to.
Yeah, so it was a miraculous story. There's a Christian guy who wasn't supposed to work that day. He told his boss, "Man, I for some reason I'm supposed to be there." He comes there. It's a big event at the Rose Bowl called Line in the Sand. I was there with a bunch of people from my church. I went down to the bathroom. I came out. I looked to have my guys who were doing security there to rotate for my men's ranch. And my heart just shut off electronically. I mean, it's called sudden cardiac death because when you hit the ground, you're gone,
yeah.
right? And so when that happened to me, this medic who wasn't supposed to be at work that day had already drove the medical cart to that side of the Rose Bowl, stopped the cart, got out, and said, "Lord, why am I at work today?" He hears something, turns around, I'm on the ground.
Unbelievable.
And he had the jumpers on his cart.
Without that, it would have been...
You're done. Yeah, so people die in the hospital from this.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, it's really...
Yeah.
So God miraculously saved my life. And
were you right with him by then? Like the
No, this is before.
Before, that's right. Yeah, yeah,
yeah. Yeah, so this is before.
Yeah.
And so then... and you would think, man, after a miracle like that, you'd be set for the rest of your life to make sure mm-hmm. you know what I mean?
Walk the straight and narrow.
Yeah, you think,
yeah.
right? But all of a sudden, I was living like today might be my last day, today yeah. be my last day. And I ended up putting myself in a position of visiting a girl that I was a fiance with, you know.
Years ago.
Yeah, and all that stuff. And just some dynamics there. And so I ended up failing. And then I, at first I tried to just, I thought I dug myself out of it. I thought I covered yeah. up myself well, whatever. And I thought I was done with it. But then years later, and like 4 years later, I had to go in for open heart surgery. And she had reached out to me again. We thought we had it, you know,
covered, where
we're, yeah. So we thought, okay, I got through that. I'm on, you know, whew, that was close.
My sin won't find me out.
Yep. You know, it's like, whew, that was really close. She reconnected with me when I had my open heart surgery, and then I went in for my surgery, and I saw her. Yeah, I told her yes, I'd call her back. And then when I got out of the hospital, the day I got out of the hospital, she started texting me because I hadn't called her back yet. And I right. just and at that moment I realized I haven't really resolved it. You know what I mean?
Right.
I'm still on the train.
Wow.
Right?
Wow.
I thought I was off the train, but I'm still on the train.
Yeah, because you're still contacting her.
Yeah. You know what I mean? So then I get this text message. And this is when I get this text message from this prophetic guy that I've known for years from up in San Francisco. And a lot of times he'll text me things that...
Sometimes they're dead on, yeah.
Yeah, but sometimes yeah. he texts me something, and I'm like trying to understand what he's even talking about, right?
Yeah.
It's kind of crazy, and I'm like... Yeah. You know, but this time he was talking about the Israelites coming out of Egypt, da, 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 and it's all in regular letters, right? Then it goes into capital letters, and it says, "Don't test God. Don't test God." even if it costs you everything, it's worth it to find the real you. Wow. And then he goes into the story about the Israelites and like regular, you know what I mean? And I tell you, those capital words, because I'm contemplating my situation, and those words jumped off that screen. If God would have sat down in a choir of angels to tell me that same thing, it couldn't have had any more impact. True. That's how impactful it was to me.
That's amazing.
And it says, even if it costs you everything, he gives me a promise. It's worth it to find the real you. Think about that.
Unbelievable.
Is that crazy?
Yeah.
And so I began to think, well, what's everything? What if I confess
ministry?
What's everything?
Marriage.
And so I concluded that, okay, if Jesus comes back next week, who do I want him to find? Well, I wanted to find a guy that's pastoring a church, got a ranch, got a satellite TV program, got businesses, all this other stuff that's going on, you know, with my heart 80-90% right.
Right.
Or would I rather have him find a single guy living in an apartment, working as a janitor with my heart 100% right?
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, I was just like, I'd rather be the single guy living in an apartment, you know? And I just had this moment of courage, you know, to say, you know, and I really didn't understand the promise to find the real you, because I was one of those pastors, probably a lot of people that say it to you, is they probably like you because you feel like, they feel like you're the real deal.
Right.
Because if you followed me around in my life, I didn't act any different at home or at the store or wherever I went, I was consistent. And people always says, Gary, I just like you. You're like the real deal, So when he said the real me to me, I didn't even really compute fully in my head, because I'm like, what do you mean, Lord? You know, of course I wasn't completely clean on confessing because of the collateral damage. But other than that, I was, you know, very much an open book, right? And so I didn't really see it. And so I ended up, you know, confessing to that. And then I resigned. I was a Foursquare minister. And I went into immediately, I just wanted to find out, because when I wanted to find out what it was when I says, I just, because sometimes when we struggle with something as leaders, we say, I just don't understand. You ever seen that thing? Mm-hmm. I just don't understand why that grabs me, why that pulls me down. I don't understand this. I don't understand, you know what I mean? And I had one of those in my life. I don't understand why, because I didn't, everything I told you I do understand now, I didn't understand then.
Right.
I hadn't gone on that journey yet. And so I just don't understand. And so I wanted to, like, you know, I told my supervisors in Foursquare, listen, I don't need any carrots. I don't want anybody. I want to go through a process, because I want to get to the root cause. I want to find out
what I don't understand. Yeah.
Right. I just want to do it. And so I got associated with a ministry called Ted Roberts, Pure Desire. And
I've heard of that.
Yeah. So Ted's a great guy. He took me on himself. And so I met with him every week for 13 years.
You know, that's a good, just a transition, and then back to what you're saying. But many pastors or leaders or anyone, they won't do that accountability. Or even if they do it for a week, like, okay, you know, I'll do it. I got caught. But it's very few. I mean, I could name some of the bigger name pastors who have fallen over the years. And I've known two or three of their accountability groups. And in all cases, they withdrew from their accountability group within, you know, a couple weeks or a month.
Well, the shame and the guilt is overwhelming when you realize you're hurting the people you love the most.
Yeah.
Your immediate family, my wife. And we had just had one of our sons pass away.
Oh, my goodness. And
so I had failed, and then he had passed away. So I didn't, he hadn't passed away, and then I failed. In that season when I was struggling and failing, he passed away, right? Wow. And so you imagine the emotions are going on in our family, right?
Beyond anything.
And yeah. I had 5 years of just a lot of trials through my businesses. We experienced a lot of the setbacks in my business as well. So there was a lot of stuff, you know, just in our life that was going on.
Yeah.
And to think that I added
to that
pain and suffering to my wife, to my kids, and then to all the people who came faithfully and supported a ministry. Yeah. And I was the visionary, and I was taking them on a journey, and all of a sudden, their leader's not there anymore. Yeah, do you understand? It's yeah. overwhelming, the regret.
I can't even imagine. Yes. Yeah.
And so it's so the enemy at that moment, I mean, he really wants to take you out. He says, man, you're in a
suicidal
pit. Like you
thoughts.
Said. No, I've never been a person that, because I've been through a lot my entire life, and so I always know you can get through it. But I could see a person, because it seems so overwhelming, it seems like,
no way out.
I'm done.
Yeah.
I'm done. My whole reputation.
Or they run back to the sin.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And the desire for me was I wanted to find out the root cause. And I wanted, matter of fact, when I confessed to my wife, I told her, I said, listen, I'm not telling you this because I want to end anything. Mm-hmm. I'm telling you this because I want our next 20 years to be the best that it can be.
Right.
Right. And because the doctor said that time frame to me, they said, this open heart surgery we did for you in 2015, mm-hmm. we think we've given you another 20 years. And before I was thinking I was going to die any day.
Yeah.
Right. And now all of a sudden, they're telling me I'm going to live for 20 years. I'm like, well, I don't want to live with this secret for 20 years. It changed the dynamic. So the good news health-wise was bad news spiritual, because I was like, when I thought I was going to die, I'm just going to die.
Yeah.
Right? And so it's not going to go much longer. You know, I'd drive in the morning to see a sunrise, and I'd say, I wonder if this is my last sunrise. But now they're saying, hey, you got 20 more years. It's like, I want things to be right. And I know there's leaders out there right now. You're struggling with things. You failed. And it seems like if you come clean, it's the devastation, the collateral damage and everything is going to be so overwhelming. There's no hope. But here's the thing is, there's a new song.
Yeah.
And that's the beautiful part of this message, is that when he pulls us out of that pit, Shane, and when it feels like it's too deep, there's no way. How is he ever going to, you know, reestablish, do anything? And I guess I'm just going, you know, honestly, I was content with, okay, Lord, whatever. I don't need no titles. I was never a title guy anyhow.
Right.
I didn't need titles and, you know, pats on the back ministry-wise and stuff. So I was content with just being, whatever I need to do, right? It was just like, I just want to serve you, Lord. But to see how he all of a sudden he uses our life when we cry out to him, and he grabs hold of us and he pulls us out and he sets us on a rock again. And God blessed me with the church I attend is called the Way World Outreach. And Pastor Marco, it was just one of my most, when I used to do a lot of kingdom events, pulling a lot of pastors together in the Inland Empire, doing a lot of unity stuff, and then, you know, impacting our region for Jesus. There's got a lot of cool stories of what God did amongst that. There's one pastor that was always just, he was very flexible. He'd turn on a dime. He would take advantage of opportunities, and he just became like, hey man, I don't know. Pastor Mark was like my favorite pastors and stuff. Right. Little did I know that he would be the one to receive me in such a way that really just instilled hope into my life at a whole new level, just from, because here's the thing. When you go in a pit, there's going to be a group of people they're going to forever remember you
always
as the guy who fell in the pit.
Yep.
Right?
Oh, you weren't saved to begin with.
You're the guy. Yeah. We know what you did. You fell in the pit. You're a pit guy, right? And then there's going to be another group of people that say, man, you came out of that pit.
Mm-hmm.
Man, God is, you know, he wants to establish you there. They'll see the song, right?
Exactly.
And then, I mean, the reason we're here today, right? Because of our friendship. And you think, you didn't see the pit guy, you saw the song guy.
Right, exactly.
Right? The new lyrics that can be sung now because I came out of the pit, right? And the enemy wants us to stay in the pit. He wants to take us out. He wants to make us done, you know?
Well, I mean, for me, it's realizing that all of us can fall in any area. You know, to think, it will never happen to me. They actually interviewed 280 of the top Christian leaders who fell about 20 years ago. And at the top of the list was, they said, it would never happen to me. It'll never happen to me.
And I don't know if I touched on that, but because that value
you did
was...
say that too.
Well,
I think that...
That's why I put myself in that situation, because my value was, I would never cross that line.
Right.
And because I had so much surety that I wouldn't cross that line, I put myself in a situation based on I think that I'll never do that.
Yeah.
Had I been more fearful, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And had a proper perspective of how vulnerable we all are,
right?
Right? Even though if you would have talked to me back then, I'm sure I could have just explained that I'm super careful, all this sort of stuff. But the bottom line is, if we're drawn, here's what I've learned. Here's a real big nugget. If I'm drawn to do it and it's a little off, it's very powerful.
Yeah.
It's not that big a deal, right? Because what we think is, well, it's not that big a deal. So if you're thinking about, you know, I'll just counsel this girl, or I'll just do this, or I'll do that, and you kind of feel inside, you know, that's not quite right. That's not that big a deal. The fact that you're wrestling with it and you're thinking about doing it, it's a big deal.
Exactly.
That means it's danger zone.
Conviction of the spirit.
It's danger zone. Wow. Right.
And so how do you, did your devotional life with the Lord fade away a little bit was good? And
no, I was.
It's amazing.
Yeah. No, I did.
You want to stay close and broken, but
here's the thing is the Lord had me on a depth of identity and who I was. So he really revealed so much. I was honestly preaching good messages because I was getting me to sustain.
Yeah.
Right. And just not crumble everything. He was infusing me with important truths and principles and dynamics and he's just continued to do that in my life. So never did I feel a separation other than when I first started going after that happened and I went back into church, it was just a different environment because when I started
it's hard to look people in the face and eyes.
Well, I didn't go back to my church, of course, but I'm just saying when I'm going into church, I was just like, it felt different being in his house. So it was a little bit of a struggle of getting
back on track
where I felt like I was on track again. But no, that word desperation, right?
Mm-hmm.
I just, you know, I've been a pursuer of Jesus my entire life. And honestly, you know, through every single pit, I've learned that. Like Paul says into the Philippians, he says, here's an old man, he's in prison.
Yep.
And he says these words, I just want to know Jesus more. Think about that. Yep. Here he is, that old.
And the power of Lord. His resurrection.
And he says, I just want to be found in him. That means when life squeezes, he wants Jesus to come out. Then he says, and I want to be conformed to his death and his resurrection. And what I've learned is the process of dying to self is what enacts the power of the resurrection in my life.
Yeah.
Right? But some of us are pretty hard-headed. And there's things in our flesh that aren't that easy to kill.
Yeah.
And but once we allow him to kill those things,
it's amazing.
There's the manifest power of.
This is a little off topic. I just thought of it, but I'm sure it's a question on the minds of many, and I've tackled it before in my books, I think. But when would a leader who falls like that, would they ever be restored to a position of a lead pastor? Or are they, you know, kind of, my thought is a significant time needs to go by, but if God, you know, begins to rebuild that person, also depends on the age of the person, I guess, how long, you know. I know of pastors who have fallen at 24 out of seminary and God gives them a church at 40, you know, after they've been broken, humble. Yeah, but there's some stances that say, you know, never, ever again. Or if you've ever been divorced, never, you know, there's a lot of that out there too.
Yeah, the whole thing about disqualifying people for certain things versus the call of God on their life. Jesus, he broke it down. He says, well, if you look on a woman, you commit adultery. Yeah. So Jesus made it clear it's a matter of the heart.
Yeah.
And that's the beautiful thing is that God does search our hearts. In 2 Corinthians chapter 3, when he talks about that we're an epistle written upon our hearts. So when we unveil our heart, whatever that journey is, and I think God knows the heart, knows that if you're genuine and what your motives of why you want to do things.
Did you submit to accountability? Has it been a significant amount of time? And, you know, there's a lot of things.
Yeah. So, you know. Yeah.
But like these guys, not to interrupt, but these guys that like they fall and then a year later they're planting a church. It's like, you know.
You know, that in my story, that I would see no way to do that. You know what I mean?
Right.
Because there's a lot to to get down to the root cause of when you're a leader and you fail in such a way that causes that kind of collateral damage. It's a deep root, and it's something that's got to don't think. Oh man, I came up there and we had a deliverance service. I got delivered from it. Praise the Lord, I'm good to go.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not saying God can do anything like that. Of course, we know that. But in my case, there was some you know, I had to deal with this. I had to deal with a lot of stuff in my life to really where I feel, you know, healthy. And also, you know, the there's a lot us leaders can do. We don't necessarily have to be the guy behind the pulpit.
Exactly right. Yeah.
It's not, I've
like
always,
what you're doing now, you're very active in ministry.
Right. And it's a lot trying to help other leaders.
Right.
You learn from my pit.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, exactly.
So, you know, the best way to stay out of that situation, don't get in the pit to begin with.
Right.
But if you do, you know, just know that don't let it destroy you. Right. And just know that you're going to get a new song, you know.
And so, you know, I don't know how much time we have, but to sum up, what I heard from you is, first and foremost, confession, repentance, getting right with the Lord needs to be the priority, no matter what the cost. And that is so true, because that relationship restored will be better than trying to hold this position. And it's hard. I'm difficult, I'm sure. I mean, I couldn't even process that, really. But that is better. Avoid the compromise even from the get-go. Even if you feel conviction to drawn towards something.
If you're thinking it's not that big a deal, but you know that you're going outside, that's your warning sign. It is a big deal, because you're telling yourself it's not that big a deal. So that's your, like, let your alarm bells.
And the enemy doesn't push you off the cliff. He sometimes takes you down one step at a time. And now you're at the bottom going, how did I get here? Because you weren't going to jump off. And that's what those little compromises are. You know, I think in that list of 280 Christians, the other thing was 80% counseled women of the opposite sex. You know, and that's just, that's, I think, standard protocol for pastors
Yeah, and I didn't do that.
Yeah,
you know, I did it. And so, but the ones that do, that I think that's really dangerous.
Yeah.
And it's hard for the women, too, because you become this great guy that listens to everything.
No, yeah, you need to.
It's just, everything gets twisted up easy. But the outcome for all of us, really, is to glorify God. And that means that we're a tangible expression of His presence, right?
Yes.
And so what I've learned, Shane, is that life is more about how we respond to it than what happens to us. And when we learn to how to respond, and so you're talking about, was I accountable? So like when I failed, when I confessed, that was a major, major thing. I'm an ex-convict, right?
Yeah, yeah.
There is nothing in me, in my natural man, that ever says to myself, I think I'm going to tell myself. You know, just naturally.
Oh, yeah. No,
right?
No, no,
I'm
yeah.
wired opposite completely. And I'm also wired in the way that you can tell me something, and you say, you could tell me something, and you don't, I can put it in a vault inside my brain, in a box, and you don't have to worry about it.
Yeah.
It's locked up. It's good. So,
yeah.
By just as a person, never ever telling myself.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, just,
and don't telling others. Yeah.
And also, I can compartmentalize. I had to be an expert at compartmentalism.
Yes.
Right? Because how to survive in a household when I loved my dad and I was sleeping with his wife. You can imagine.
Yeah.
I had to become an expert as compartmentalizing things.
Yeah, I forget what it's called. It's that term disengage, or just, you're almost like split personality, even though you're not.
You put it in a little box. Yeah. And that probably helped me a lot in my ability to be able to seek the Lord,
get through all those sort of things.
Cause I just,
true.
I had
not
that
all
little box I could put that in.
You know what? It just dawned on me a couple weeks ago, Wednesday night, we had a friend of mine, ex-felon, gave a testimony, Russell, then Rick, ex-felon, gave a testimony. And then you're giving it here, and then tonight Richard's going to be here. It's like four in a row. What a blessing as far as God using the least likely. And I'm drawn towards those who are humble and broken. It's really hard for me to be around arrogant people that haven't really experienced that desperation, that they've dug themselves out of the pit with God's help, and because of that, they are gracious, gentle, to be loving, understanding. You know, so it does something to you. It really, it's almost like, and I don't want to encourage sin, God forbid, but it's when we fall, God often uses those times to really, really fine tune and shape our character.
Well, two things I want to comment on that is, one is, all of a sudden I identify with King David after I fell.
Absolutely.
And I said, oh man, I said, King David failed with adultery. But yet he was known as a man after God's own heart.
It's amazing.
And he goes all the way through the New Testament. So that story gave me hope. And the other thought that I wanted to share was the we were talking about, oh man, I just forgot about it, what the other topic we were talking about, but they're loving much. So when I, when I got saved at Tracy Penitentiary, and I'll kind of maybe use this as kind of our sort of closing thing. The problem that I had with thinking about my life in Jesus was, if there was a God, I was convinced that there was, he would never want anything to do with me.
Yep.
Right? And I remember when I went to that prison chapel and I was like in the middle, halfway through, right in the middle there, and they started singing this little kid song. And it was, "Yes, Jesus loves me."
Oh, yeah.
Yes. And I just started my prison sentence. I'm 21, 20 years old, something like that, right? And I'm like trying to process what it takes to be in prison, a convict guy. Mm-hmm. I'm in this chapel and all these convicts around. And somehow I knew that was a little kid song.
Yeah.
And the first thing that comes to my mind is, these guys are singing a little kid song, right? But then I started singing it. Yes, Jesus loves
The love
me,
of God.
Right? Yeah. And it just like it poked my heart a little bit, right? Yep. Like, dude, he loves me. And then I sang it again. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, wow. All of a sudden, this heart, for the first time ever, started believing that Jesus loved me.
Yes.
You know, and the power of that love that will reach down and grab a hold of you. And that was the day in July of 1988 that I went forward and I received Christ in my life. But it was that realization that Jesus loved me. And it's that great love that I think keeps you so desperate.
Yeah.
And so no matter what, you know, all the stuff I'd done as a young man up to that point, and I used to my crimes at that time, I used to manufacture speed. I was a dope fiend, all that sort of stuff. So I might
sell eight balls.
Yeah, no pounds for
me. Pounds. But, oh gosh.
But that whole lifestyle and all the crazy other stuff associated with that lifestyle, that was me. That was my identity. Mm-hmm. So there's nothing about my life that I thought there's a God in heaven that he would want anything to do with me, right?
Wow.
And so, but you know, when you fail as a leader and you hurt people that you really care about, you really love,
right,
and you feel so low, right? You're just like, man, and you feel like you're in that pit and you're just stuck. And then you realize that, man, he's not done with me yet. Yeah. His love and his grace, he'll pull me out.
Wow.
He pulls me out of that muck and mire. His arm's not too short. He'll pull me out. He'll set my feet on a rock.
And my ear's not too heavy. Right. I can hear.
He establishes my goings. He's given me, and he's blessed me where I'm at. Like I said, the Way World Outreach is an amazing church. Yeah. I'm doing a lot of
where
stuff
can
there.
People find you? If they, Gary Hornsby?
Oh, easy. Just type. Instagram. My name's not real popular, so you can just type me on Instagram, Facebook, or whatever.
Okay.
But I attend the Way World Outreach in San Francisco.
And I would encourage, you know, even speaking at men's events. You know, you've got people here or leaders that watch
that's
this.
That's like one of the main things I do.
Yeah, we want to get you out here soon, too, as well. So, all right, Gary, I want to, you know, just end with a thought as I'm thinking about all this is we can still hold to the truth of God's word. We can still pursue holiness, hate sin, but we can also still love people and show mercy and grace and find that balance. You know, that balance does exist because you see some people, it's all about grace and mercy. It doesn't even matter if you fall, no big deal. But then you have the other side that's so rigid. And if you fall, you're never allowed back in the doors of the church.
Yeah.
You know, and neither extreme is good.
Here's a principle that I hope everybody gets. When you pursue Jesus, you find the real you.
Yes.
Remember that promise?
Absolutely.
It may cost you everything.
Yeah,
but you're going to find the real you. And what I love about my life right now,
it's a real Gary.
I'm not modifying. Lord bless me with another wife. I don't modify me at all in any circumstance other than saying, Holy Spirit, what's my responsibility?
Yes.
I try to follow that as my guideline. So that's my daily calibration.
Because what happens is you're pursuing him, all the dross is removed, the refiner's fire.
Right.
And the real you comes out because you're open, you're honest, you're transparent, you're not trying to hide things. And because of that, here's the real me, and Jesus loves me just no matter how I am. He restores and he holds me all together. So anyway, appreciate you coming out here
Thanks
to do this.
Me.
And again, this is Pastors Unplugged. Make sure to subscribe at all the different platforms, iTunes, Podbeam, YouTube, Rumble. I think there's 16 or so different platforms. And then obviously contact Gary if you need someone to come speak at a men's event. I can tell it would be a great message, very encouraging for the men. So
Thanks for
signing
me.
Off, thank you for watching this episode.